We'll
And
eat too.
the greatest tradition is waking up and seeing that face.
And seeing that face. Ooh, and we flirt all the time, girl. We're always
like, I just love that.
These people don't know that about you. They know you and the regular you in the stage, but you are the most beautiful in the morning. The first thing in the morning, you're the most beautiful.
He's kind of got for his eyes because, you know, I have on a head wrap. I'm looking like you already know, okay?
Yeah.
But I love this man. Face. You know, I love this man.
Yeah, so beautiful.
She's got something special inside of her that's coming out. And I told her that a long time ago. Okay. I mean, I just love this woman. I want to cry.
And that video was kind of a deep dive right into our hearts, wasn't it? I don't know if you recognize who that was. Nicole C. Mullins, who sang that great song, My Redeemer Lives, about 15 or 20 years ago, if you're trying to remember how you know her. And Nicole went through some struggles in her life, including a divorce. And a husband, I think, one of whom had run around on her. She experienced what it was like to be abandoned, rejected, refused, betrayed, as some of you have. And God then brought this incredible man into her life, and she married him in October 2021. And if you're like me, you're thinking, where are the cookie cutters? No pressure to all the gentlemen in the room, but I would qualify that video by saying they're on their honeymoon. They've only been married 6 months, and it would be good to do that again in 10 years and see if he's still saying the same things, okay? And for those who maybe, like me, are still single and not married, you may be saying, where is that guy that behaves like that? So it's a lot of pressure on the guy and the girl for us to experience that perfect relationship. And I think that what touched me as I listened to that video, and it was a long interview, and I took those clips out, and Shelley helped me to put those two things together, was the fact that he loves her first thing in the morning when nobody else sees her without her makeup, she's got her hair wrap on, and he loves her. And you know why I think he loves her? It's not because of her beautiful face, and she is a stunningly gorgeous woman. It's not about her face. It's about what he sees in her heart. He recognizes something in her heart that is beautiful. He says, God is birthing something in her. And how many of us would love to have somebody saying that to us? You are beautiful. I love this face. There is something in you that I am birthing, that is beautiful, that was created for me, for my glory. And I think God brought me here this morning to tell you he's saying that to you. You might never have heard a man say that. Physically, that would be really hard for some guys to say. But God says it. How do I know that? Because if you go to Song of Songs, and if you look in your book here, I gave you a little book, and those of you who are watching online, we have a booklet available, a link with the streamline video is there. You can pick up the book and the notes, but in the Song of Songs on page 2 at the bottom there, here's what the beloved is saying to the woman, and it's really a picture of what Jesus is saying to his bride, the church. At the bottom of that page, it says, you are beautiful, my love. You are beautiful. And in Song of Solomon, chapter 2, verse 14, he says, let me see your face. Let me hear your voice, for your voice is sweet and your face is lovely. I don't know about you, but when I first read those verses some years ago, I had a really hard time. And when we read this in some of our groups, I know women have a struggle with this. Like, really? Somebody looks at my face and thinks I'm beautiful? That I can look at the heart of God and he sees that kind of beauty in me? It's embarrassing. I don't deserve it. I'm unworthy of that kind of love. Maybe that's you today, and I hope by the end of today you will know how much you're loved And that you may have never heard it from a physical voice through a father, a mother, a husband, even a child, to tell you that you're beautiful, you're worthy, you are worth love. Somebody sees your beauty. But I want to tell you, it's not because you've got a beautiful face. It's because he looks on the inside. You see, in the Bible, intimacy is described through the face. Time and over again, God speaks about, seek my face. And David says in Psalm 27, your face I will seek. We're going to read some verses this morning that talk about how many times God talks about seeking his face. And he doesn't necessarily mean face to face, because in the Old Testament it said, no man has seen God and lived. But he's talking about seeking him in the intimate place of your heart. Look to me. Look at me. God is inviting us to look at him today because he wants to look in our faces and speak some truth to us. I want to show you another video, which is something that came from the royal wedding in 2011. Shelley, if we could have that quick.
I'll never let you go again like I did. Oh, I used to say I would never fall in love again until I found her. I said I would never fall unless it's you I fall into. I was lost within the darkness, but then I found her.
Hug of the heart, isn't it? That perfect marriage, common ordinary girl. Kate, who is now Princess Kate, was just an ordinary woman. Her parents were business people. She didn't grow up with any royal heritage. In fact, her grandmother lived in a slum, you would call it a slum, very poor area in England. And she met Will at school, and she captured his heart. And he had to get permission from the royal family to move to marry somebody who was not of royal blood. He had to get special permission to marry her. And the thing that I loved about this marriage, this clip, when I was watching it back in 2011, I was actually in India, and we were talking about the bride, and so this was just the perfect timing. But there were two things that the commentators said at the time. And there were, you know, you get lip readers when these events happen. And so they were lip reading and commentating real time that when Kate got down to the bottom of that aisle and she stands in front of Will, he says to her, "You are beautiful." And you couldn't see that because I'm not a lip reader. You couldn't probably see it there. All we remember is the struggling with the ring, which makes it very human. But before that, when he saw her for the first time, he said, "You are beautiful." And as they left the church, the cathedral, and they got into the royal carriage and they're driving off, the news commentator lip reader said that she turned to Will and she said, "Are you happy?" And those two statements to me summarize the intimate conversation that happens in a relationship between a couple when each one is not consumed with themselves, but they're consumed with the happiness of the other. His eyes were focused on her beauty, and her eyes are focused on pleasing him. And that's God's heart. That's God's plan for us. If you don't remember anything else today, I hope you would take those two things away, that we were created to please him. And when he looks at us, he calls us beautiful, not because of anything that we've done, but because of everything that he's done. His beauty in us. There's a verse that says on the top of your page too. In fact, I've written a statement here that Augustine wrote hundreds of years ago. He said, "Thou hast formed us for thyself, and our hearts are restless until they find their rest in you." You have formed us the writer says, for yourself, and our hearts are restless until they find their rest in you. How many things do we look for to find that will fill the longings of deep longings of our hearts, to hear the things that these women have heard? We're looking everywhere, and the bottom line is, we won't find it until we come to our Maker. And in Isaiah 54, verse 5, it says, for your husband is your maker, is your husband. Your Maker, the one who created you, is also your husband, the Holy One of Israel, your Redeemer, pointing to Jesus. He is our heavenly husband. What does that all mean? Let me share an example, another one from the royal family. You may never have heard of the name Peter Phillips. Has anybody heard the name Peter Phillips? Well, you might know somebody called Peter Phillips, but you know Peter. Who's Peter Phillips? Well done. You must be a royal follower. Being in the United States, there's probably really few people would know that. But Peter Phillips is the eldest grandson of the late Queen of England. And her grandson, Peter Phillips, was the first child of her daughter, Anne, Princess Anne. You might have heard of Princess Anne. And he has lived a very low-key life. He's not in the royal eye, although he goes to all the royal functions and family parties and everything. So he's very much a part of the family, but he doesn't portray that. And he went to Canada, and he was hanging out at the race course there for the Canadian Grand Prix. And while he was there, he met this girl who he fell in love with. And they dated for 6 weeks. And as he was dating her, obviously getting more and more attracted to her, he realized he was going to have to declare who he was. And so it was about 6 weeks into the relationship that he tells her that he's grandson to the Queen of England. Can you imagine? Okay, you thought that only happened in Hallmark movies. And I think Hallmark upped their game on, you know, American girl gets European prince after 2011 when Kate married Will. But there have been other real life stories that have been happening. So it's not just a Hallmark movie. It actually does happen. Can you imagine what that girl found out? To me, when I heard that story, that testimony, if you like, I was thinking about what our ministry is with Love Unveiled. It's a revelation of God's love. If you know Jesus as your Savior, you may not even know him in that way yet. You may have heard about him, but you don't really know him in terms of having had a personal relationship. He has not come into your life and changed you, but you have heard about him. And if you're in that place, then we're going to invite you to know him today as your Savior. And if you do know him as your Savior and Lord, and you've met him, and you have been brought out of the kingdom of darkness, set free to live in the kingdom of the Son of his love, can I just tell you, you have not arrived in knowing him. Every time I get deep into this word, when I'm preparing for workshops or for Let's Get Real, I start weeping at the revelation of who God is and who Jesus is. I'm amazed how, I'm 60, thank you for my 15th anniversary celebration today, but I was 60 this year as well. And so 60 years, I was born again when I was 9, but all those years of following the Lord, I still, more than ever, can weep when I open this book and realize how much more there is to know about this God, this King, this Jesus that we have been united with. So I hope today that God is going to open your eyes, that he's going to lift the veil a little bit more, or maybe a whole lot more, for you to see who he is in a way that will be life-changing and change the trajectory of your life from this point on. Because if we're not looking for that, we're dead. We're not alive. Jesus is alive. And in your marriage, you know, if you are married or in any relationship, it's the more we get to know somebody, there's always something new to know. And things get boring when we just accept that we think we know everything about the other person. It needs to get shaken up. We need to take time and attention to the relationship. Let me go back to Kate. I see a picture, a comparison of our relationship with Jesus. When Kate married Will, the day that she put that ring on her finger, he put the ring and struggled to put the ring on her finger, everything changed for her. in that moment, she was no longer Kate. She had to leave behind her life with her family. She had to make some concessions to move into his life. And some of those things were great. She got a new name, she got a new house, she got a whole new wardrobe. She got a new title, she got position, she got influence, she got power. She had a new identity with him. It opened up the door to all sorts of things. But can I tell you this? It was a life of consecration to serve her husband and be allegiant to the people that he was allegiant to. She had to commit to serve him and to serve his people. The Queen of England, the Queen of the United Kingdom, she just died. And there was so much came out about her life. And one of the things that came out was how, first of all, when she was crowned queen, she gave her allegiance to Jesus. She said, I am submissive to him. He is my king. And because I submit to him, I surrender my life to serve his people. That's what Kate's saying. Because I marry Will, I surrender to his calling. Hey, guess what, girls? If we have surrendered to Jesus, we're saying, I give up my life because now I belong to him and I am surrendered to his calling. To his calling. I no longer own myself. I am now betrothed to another. And that's the whole language of the Bible. When we start our teaching in Love Unveiled, we don't start straight with the bride. So if you've not been through any Love Unveiled teaching and you're going like, wow, this can feel a deep dive. To dive into talking about marriage when you've been in a broken marriage or you've not been in a marriage and your heart's hurting, those are the things that we desire. Every woman desires. It's part of who we are. It's been there since Genesis. We have longings and we have desires. Many of us have been broken in relationships with men, sadly. And some of us have experienced wonderful relationships with men. But that's a really hard discussion to have. And so I think God, in his wisdom, he doesn't introduce himself to us straight away as the husband, I would suggest. The New Testament in the Gospel of John, chapter 1, says that whoever received him and believed in him, first of all, became his child. And when I come into the world physically, my first relationship with any creature, any human being, is with a parent, a mother and father. God's intention was that we would grow, first of all, emotionally, physically, mentally, spiritually, in the context, in the safe environment of a mother and a father. That was God's plan. Now, because of sin, because of brokenness, because of disobedience in the Garden of Eden, that plan broke down pretty badly on the first go around, right from the beginning, right? So everybody has suffered that is not perfect in our broken humanity, but it was God's plan that that's how it would start, that it would begin with us following him as his children and getting to know him as being daughters and sons. But multiplication, reproduction of human beings doesn't come by just being his daughters. It starts by knowing your identity as his daughter. But multiplication comes in humanity when a man and a woman become very intimate. In fact, in Genesis chapter 4 and verse 1, it says, Adam knew his wife Eve, and she gave birth to a son called Seth. And the word knew, to know, means to know intimately. And here's the difference. In the New King James translation, the writers use two different words in the Hebrew to describe having an intimate physical relationship. The word knowing means it's between a husband and a wife, it's under God's banner, and it is intimate, and it produces children in a family environment. There's another word that's used when two people come together sexually, and that word is lay. He lay with her. David lay with Bathsheba when she was still married to somebody else. That was a sexual relationship that was outside the boundary of marriage. It was about their feelings, their emotions, their selfishness. It was not what God intended. It is not what God intends for either physical fruitfulness or spiritual fruitfulness. In Hosea chapter 6, verse 3, God says, I want you to know me. Pursue knowing me so that I can come to you like rain. The word know means know me intimately, the same way he was talking to Adam and Eve. Physically, he wants us to know him intimately. In John chapter 17, verse 3, Jesus says, and this is eternal life. What? What is eternal life? That you may know him. That they may know God, the only God, and his son, Jesus Christ. If I want eternal life, it's about knowing God intimately. It's about having a relationship where he literally comes and lives in my heart. He lives in me. I live in him. We become one. And out of that unity, Jesus says, if you abide in me, you will bear much fruit. If I want to have physical intimacy, if I want to have children, rather, the way God planned it was a man and a woman come together intimately in the context of marriage, and they reproduce children in a healthy environment and help those kids to grow up. And those healthy kids grow up and they meet somebody and they develop emotions that put them into a relationship with another human being, and they get together intimately and they reproduce, and that was God's plan. And Satan's really tried to screw that up, and he's doing really a great job right now in trying to confuse people and bring delusion. But it hasn't stopped God's plan. Just because we don't understand the plan or we get off track, this doesn't change God's word. God's word still stands. His principles and his way still stands. But the lesson for us today is that all of that will pass away, but what will last forever is our intimacy with him. So I think it's really important that we understand God's heart for our relationship with him. He has invited us into a relationship of marriage. You might surprise you to know that this whole entire book, and I have no idea why we don't talk about this more, really, in the body of Christ, because this book starts with marriage and finishes with marriage. If you open your book, your Bible, if you have your Bible, turn to Genesis chapter 4, the verse that I've just read. Genesis 4. And verse 1. So we're right in the first book of the Bible. Now Adam knew Eve his wife, and she conceived, and she bore Cain, and said, I have acquired a man from the Lord. There we have the reproduction. Now I want you to go back to chapter 2. I actually meant to go to chapter 2, but let's go to chapter 2, verse 24 and 25. Sorry, I'm going to take it from 23. And Adam said, this is now bone of my bones, flesh of my flesh. She will be called woman because she was taken out of man. Therefore, a man will leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife, and they will become one flesh. God's plan for man and woman to become one flesh, to be unified, was right there in the beginning, from the very first book of the Bible. Now, if you go to Revelation, to the very last book and the last chapter of the Bible, you're going to read in chapter 22, verse 17, and the Spirit and the bride say, come. The Spirit and the bride say, come. And we're going to talk more about that today. In this book, this precious, amazing, deep dive into God's heart, from Genesis to Revelation, is a story of God's love pursuing his children as a father and pursuing a bride. But it's not about human sensual love, which breaks down. We know that. It's talking about a spiritual love, a divine love that comes from God's heart, and his purpose from the very beginning of creating human beings was to enter into a unity with us, a oneness with us, which will last forever. So if you've got a broken heart today, if you've been disappointed because you've never been married, if you're in a broken marriage or your marriage right now is really struggling, or if you were in a marriage that has broken down and it's still painful, I am sorry. I am so sorry. I've gone through years of heartache dealing with these things. So I'm just because I'm single now, I've come to a point where I've released and I'm content with where I am because I found this. I found the one who my heart longs for. He's the only one that satisfies our needs. But I know that the journey to getting there did not happen when I came out of the womb. It is a journey of pain and struggle before I come to the place of surrender to say, He is everything. He is enough. And this Bible tells us, if you will take the time and help, today we're going to help us to dig into this, I hope, but take the time to know Him, to know Him personally. He's the only one that can meet those deep desires. Throughout the Bible, He gives us examples of His desire for marriage. And one of those I want to share with you this morning is in Genesis chapter 24. Genesis chapter 24 is the story of Rebecca. It's about Rebecca being a wife for Isaac. And here's the, for me, the amazing thing, reading the Bible, everything just fits. God's plan is so incredible, how He writes things for us. In Genesis chapter 22, we have the story of Isaac, the testimony of Isaac being led up the mountain to be surrendered, to be sacrificed. The child of the promise was going to be given up. Abraham was called to lay down his son. And so here's this test. But what is Isaac? Isaac is a type, a picture of Jesus. It's pointing forward to another Isaac who will become Jesus. And Abraham represents the father. It's a picture of the father in this story. And so as Isaac was being led up that mountain to be sacrificed, already God was planning a bride for Isaac. If you read at the very end of the chapter, Genesis chapter 22, verse 23, it's a genealogy from Abraham's relatives. And in verse 23, it says, "And Bethuel begot Rebekah." Now, why on earth that would be right at the end of this story about Isaac about to be sacrificed? I think it's like as Isaac was coming up the mountain with his father to be sacrificed, God was bringing a bride up the other side. Now, what does that point to? Jesus was the one that was going to be the sacrifice, because God stepped in and said to Abraham, "You don't have to do it. I have a sacrifice. I myself will provide the sacrifice. I'm going to send the one that will die and pay for the bride who has a struggle trying to follow me." And so you've got Isaac about to lay his life down, a type of Jesus, and already there's a Rebecca. And who's Rebecca? Us. The bride, the church. We get a glimpse of her in chapter 22. And then we get into chapter 24. And Abraham is now old, and it says he's well advanced in years. And the Lord blessed Abraham. And verse 2, Abraham said to the oldest servant in his house, and by the way, the servant is a type of the Holy Spirit. So the father says to the servant, "Put your hand under my thigh," which is like a committing a promise. Verse 3, "I will make you swear by the Lord, the God of heaven and of earth, that you will not take a wife from my son among the daughters of the Canaanites with, among whom I dwell." That's a type of don't take them from the world, but take them from your own kindred spirit, those who are linked in the same family, which would be God's family. "Go to my country to my family and take a wife for my son Isaac." And the servant said to him, "Perhaps the woman will not be willing to follow me to this land. Must I take your son back to the land from which you came?" But Abraham said to him, "Beware that you don't take my son there. The Lord God of heaven, who took me from my father's house, from that land, my family, who spoke to me and swore to me, saying, 'To your descendants I've given this land,' he will send his angel before you, and you shall take a wife for my son from there. And if the wife is not willing to follow, then you'll be released from your oath. Only don't take my son back." So the servant goes, and here, go to verse 10. "Then the servant took 10 of his master's camels, and he departed, for all his master's goods were in his hand. And he arose, and he went to Mesopotamia, to the city of Nahor. And he made his camels kneel down by outside by the city, by a well of water at evening time, the time when women go out to draw water." I want you to take a note of that. Evening time is when women normally go to draw water. Take hold of that thought, because we're going to come back to that thought. Then he said, O Lord, my master Abraham, please give me success this day and show kindness to my master Abraham. Behold, here I stand at the well, and the daughters of the men of the city are coming out to draw water. Now let it be that the young woman to whom I say, please let down your pitcher so that I can drink, and she says, drink, and I will also give to your camels, let her be the one you've appointed for your servant Isaac. And by this I'll know that you've shown kindness to my master. It happened before he'd finished speaking that, behold, Rebekah, who was born to Bethuel, son of Milcah, the wife of Nahor, Abraham's brother, came out with a pitcher on her shoulder. Now, the young woman was beautiful to behold. She was a virgin. No man had known her. And she went down to the well, filled her pitcher, and came up. And the servant ran to meet her and said, please, let me drink a little water. She said, drink, my lord. She quickly put her pitcher down and gave him a drink. When she'd finished giving him a drink, she said, I'll also draw water for your camels until they finish drinking. Then she quickly emptied her pitcher into the trough, ran back to the well to draw water for his camels. And the man, wondering at her, remained silent so as to know whether the Lord had made his journey prosperous or not. And it was when the camels had finished drinking that the man took a golden nose ring weighing half a shekel, two bracelets for her wrist weighing 10 shekels of gold, and said, whose daughter are you? Please tell me, is there room in your father's house? She said to him, I'm the daughter of Bethuel, Malchus' son, whom she bore to Nahor. Moreover, she said, we have both straw and feed enough and room to lodge. And the man bowed down his head and worshipped the Lord and said, blessed be the Lord of God of my master Abraham, who has not forsaken his mercy and his truth towards my master. As for me being on the way, the Lord led me to the house of my brethren. So the young woman ran and told her mother's household these things. Now, Rebekah had a brother whose name was Laban, and we meet Laban later in the story. But if you go on, and I encourage you to read the rest of this chapter when you get home, he goes to the house, they shower him with hospitality, they feed him, his camels are taken care of, he's taken care of, and gifts are poured out on the family as well as onto Rebekah. And then there comes a moment when he tells the family his business. He recites how he had this Holy Spirit moment. He prays for this woman. She shows up at the well, does exactly what he prayed for. And that's just how God leads us when he's leading the Spirit. But here, let's jump to chapter 24, verse 54, or verse 53. The servant brought out jewelry of silver, jewelry of gold, and clothing, and gave them to Rebekah. He also gave precious things to her brother and to her mother. And he and the men who were with him ate and drank and stayed all night. Then they arose in the morning and said, send me to my master. But her brother and her mother said, let the young woman stay with us a few days, at least 10, and after that she can go. And he said to them, do not hinder me, since the Lord has prospered me. Send me away so that I may go to my master. And they said, well, let's call the woman and ask her personally. Then they called Rebekah and said to her, will you go with this man? And she said, I will go. So they sent away Rebekah, their sister, and her nurse, and Abraham's servant and his men. And they blessed Rebekah and said to her, our sister, may you become the mother of thousands and ten thousands. So Rebekah and her maids arose, and they rode on camels and followed the man. So the servant took Rebekah and departed. Now Isaac came from the way of Beer Lahai Ro, for he dwelt in the south. And Isaac went out to meditate in the field, and he lifted up his eyes and looking, and there the camels were coming. And Rebekah lifted up her eyes, and when she saw Isaac, she dismounted from her camel. For she said to the servant, who's this man walking in the field to meet us? And the servant said, it's my master. So she took a veil and she covered herself. And the servant told Isaac all the things that had been done. And Isaac brought her into his mother Sarah's tent, and he took Rebekah, and she became his wife, and he loved her. So Isaac was comforted after his mother's death. What an incredible story. And it's not just a fairy tale. It's real. I'm telling you, there are things in the Bible that are beyond epic movies. This book, you can't make this up. You cannot put this in a movie. This word is filled with the most incredible things from the heart of God. The good, the bad, the ugly, and the wonderful are all included in this book. And this story actually happened. It's real. Rebekah was just a human, and we see her mess up couple of times as well. But the type of picture that we're being given is a picture of the bride that God is looking for. First of all, she is wooed by the Spirit. She'd never met Isaac. The serpent goes out, he goes out and he prays that God will give him favor. And you know what? The Holy Spirit comes in answer to pray to woo us to the bridegroom, a bridegroom that we have never seen face to face in person. We come in this day through faith. And when the Holy Spirit comes and invites us, he's looking to see what our hearts are. This woman's heart was responsive before she even knew what the invitation was. She was hospitable. She was generous. She was a hard worker. She was industrious. She was humble. She was a servant heart. She was the perfect wife. She was the type of the bride that God is looking for among us, not just among women. And by the way, the bride isn't just women. It's hard for guys to get some of that concept, I've no doubt. But the bride is about the whole body of Christ. It's not just individual, but God looks at individual hearts and calls individual hearts into the bride. He calls sons and daughters who become the unity of the bride. And so here's a daughter being called, but there's also a son, which is Isaac, who has been called. And the daughter is being prepared for the son. So he's looking, the servant's looking for a woman with the right heart. And when he finds her, he gives her gifts. And then they go to the family, they make the offer. And now he says, the woman has to come back with me to meet the bridegroom. And what do the family do? Well, can she not just stay a few days? You know, let her just hang out with us. We don't want her to go. Don't let her go. We'll never see her again. She's going to some far off place on a camel and we might never see her again. Let her just stay with us. The spirit says, no. No, you're called to come with me. Leave father and mother's home and follow me. Come with me immediately. There is no waiting. As Jesus said to the young man, you give up everything and follow me. And he couldn't. You want to join the bridegroom? You got to give it all up. You got to put some things down, everything down. It costs everything. She gave everything up to follow somebody that she never knew. First Peter, there's a verse in 1 Peter chapter 1, I think it's verse 8. And Peter says, it's so much greater for those who have never seen him, but yet have loved him. Though you've never seen him, you love him. You love him by faith. When the Holy Spirit comes to call our hearts and we're responsive and we say, yes, Jesus, I accept your invitation. We do it by faith. And that's a beautiful thing to the Lord. And it was a beautiful thing to the Holy Spirit through this servant here. When he says, bring the woman, let's ask her. You see, the woman has a choice. She wasn't in a type of arranged marriage where she was no choice. She's being sold off and she just has to go wherever they tell her to go. No, they've said, bring the woman. She has a decision to make. You want to go now or not? She says, let's go. That's obedience. That's responding to the Spirit in your heart. This woman knew, let's go. And so they go. She goes to a country she's never been to meet a man she's never seen. She goes by faith, trusting, and I think probably seeing the heart of this servant and the way he's described the groom and the gifts that he's given her, all those things draw her heart, just as they draw our hearts to Jesus. What are the things that God sends to us to draw our hearts to Jesus? First of all, the Holy Spirit. He draws us, and then he gives us gifts, and he blesses us. And it causes us, it should cause us, to repent and turn to him, because Paul says that it's the goodness of God that causes us to repent. It's not the hellfire, usually. It's the goodness that makes us weep, because we know we don't deserve it. But it's his goodness. And when she meets Isaac, she covers herself. You might go, well, wow, that's weird. Why does she cover herself? Why? Because it's a symbol of separation. That she is only for him. That no other man can look at her when she is with her bridegroom. That we are called to be separated. Be ye holy as I am holy, says the Lord. And she's called to be a comfort for Isaac. I think about Will when he married Kate, that he was in deep mourning for the loss of his mother, Princess Diana. And what a comfort she was to him. What a help in all his heaviness of the responsibility that he has, being front line of media and all that, you know, comes with being a figurehead without true power. And she comes along and she comforts him, and she's there to walk through life with him. And that's what Jesus is looking for in his bride, someone who will comfort him in all the sorrow that he bears in a broken world. And he calls us. Have you ever thought about being a comfort to God's heart? We ask him to comfort us. But you know what? There's a place, as it said, Kate said to Will, do I please you? Do we please him? Do we bring comfort? You know what? I believe this room this morning is bringing joy to the heart of God, that it makes the bridegroom smile. The Father is pleased today to see women who appreciate the bridegroom. You came because of the message, Royal Bride, and that was God's invitation. You said yes. You came, and he wants to bless you in that. Sadly, not everybody was so responsive. In the rest of the Old Testament, we see so many times where God's heart was broken by his people. In the Old Testament, God is called husband to Israel, his wife, who was a very adulterous wife. And if you read through the Old Testament, how many times do we read that they turn their backs to him instead of their face? It says, literally says that, they turned their faces and they gave him their back. Can you imagine? I am God, I am your husband, and he's standing here saying, I love you, I give you all good gifts, come and follow me and I will bless you and I will make you a great nation. That's what they did. And look how it happened. Turn to Ezekiel chapter 16. Here's an example. If I can read this without crying, be a miracle, because I've read this about 100 times in the last 3 weeks, and every time, even this morning, I read this, I couldn't stop crying. Ezekiel chapter 16, I'm going to start at verse 1. The word of the Lord came to me, to Ezekiel the prophet, saying, son of man, cause Jerusalem to know her abominations. And thus says the Lord God to Jerusalem, your birth and your nativity are from the land of Canaan. Your father was an Amorite and your mother a Hittite. Now, just a bit of history here. Jerusalem was not always the capital of Israel. Jerusalem was originally a Canaanite city, town. And God brought it about that Jerusalem became the capital of Israel. And he's using this as an example to say that when he first saw Jerusalem, they were just like a baby lying in their dirt, which is a type of us living in our sin. Canaan represents sin and outside of God's promise and grace. So here they are, verse 3. Your birth and your nativity from the land of Canaan, your father was an Amorite, your mother was a Hittite. Verse 4, as for your nativity, on the day you were born, your navel cord was not cut, nor were you washed in water to cleanse you. You were not rubbed with salt to cleansing them, nor were you wrapped in swaddling clothes. Verse 5, no, I pitied you to do any of these things for you. Like nobody was taking care of you as this baby. No, I pitied you to do any of these things, to have compassion on you. But you were thrown out into the open field when you yourself were loathed on the day you were born. Like a baby being rejected. Like a child that was unwanted, filthy, covered in blood, and just thrown away. That's what God is saying. Israel, Jerusalem was like. And when I passed by you and I saw you struggling in your own blood, I said to you in your blood, live! Yes, I said to you in your blood, live. I made you thrive like a plant in the field, and you grow, matured, and became very beautiful. Your breasts were formed, your hair grew, but you were naked and bare. When I passed you by again and looked upon you, indeed your time was the time of love. So I spread my wing over you, and I covered you with your nakedness. And I swore an oath to you, and I entered into a covenant with you, and you became mine, says the Lord. Then I washed you in water. Yes, I thoroughly washed off your blood, and I anointed you with oil. And I think about when he says in John chapter 3, verse 5, you have to be born again by the Spirit and truth, by the water and the Spirit. That is the truth and the Holy Spirit, the Word of God and the Spirit. And right here, that's what God is saying to Jerusalem, you need the word of God. I washed you in water. I thoroughly washed off your blood. I anointed you with oil, which is the Holy Spirit. I clothed you in embroidered cloths. That's all the beauty that God gives you. And I put sandals of badger skin on your feet. I clothed you with fine linen and covered you with silk. I adorned you with ornaments, put bracelets on your wrists and a chain on your neck. I put a jewel in your nose, earrings in your ears, and a beautiful crown on your head. Thus you were adorned with gold and silver, and your clothing was of fine linen, that's purity, and silk and embroidered cloth. You ate my pastry of the fine flour, honey and oil. You were exceedingly beautiful, and you succeeded to royalty. Your fame went out among the nations because of your beauty, for it was perfect through my splendor, which I put on you, says the Lord. You see the beauty that God desired for Israel, for his people? He's given her everything. And you would think that they would be saying, thank you God for taking me, for rescuing me, for making me new, for putting a crown on my head, for washing me off and robing me like a queen. But no, because verse 15 says, but you trusted in your own beauty, you played the harlot because of your fame, and you poured out your harlotry on everybody passing by who would have it. They played the harlot, and they used what God had given them, and they gave it away to idols. They got bored with God. You see, they didn't want a God that they couldn't see. They wanted something that they could touch and feel and worship. Idols, things, other gods from other nations were their temptation. Constantly through the Old Testament, that's what we see, constantly. And it broke the heart of God. If we don't think that God has emotions when he looks down on us today, that it is not hurting his heart to see us turning away from what he's given us, then we don't know God. We don't know him. His heart was broken over and over and over again for a people that he was wooing and did everything for. And they wouldn't have him. He goes on at the end of the chapter. Please go back and read this. You'll read what they did. It's just so sad. It's even sadder that it's a reflection of who we all are. That this is us. Verse 28. You also played the harlot with the Assyrians because you were insatiable. Indeed, you played the harlot with them and you still were not satisfied. Moreover, you multiplied your acts of harlotry as far as the land of the trader Chaldea, and even then you were not satisfied. How degenerate is your heart, says the Lord, seeing you do these things, the deeds of a brazen harlot. Verse 32, you are an adulterous wife who takes strangers instead of her husband. God's broken heart for the adultery of his people. And if that was the end of the story, it would be really desperate. But it's not. It's not. Praise God, because his heart continually is pursuing us. If you go to page 4 in your notes, or you can turn to Isaiah chapter 53, God provides the answer himself. Who is this bridegroom that we've been talking about? God says to Israel through the prophet Isaiah. I'm going to read from the NIV translation, which is just such a beautiful rendition of Isaiah 53. He grew up before him like a tender shoot, and like a root out of dry ground, he had no beauty or majesty to attract us to him. Nothing in his appearance that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by mankind, a man of suffering and familiar with pain, like one from whom people hide their faces. He was despised and we held him in low esteem. A man of sorrows, acquainted with grief. Surely he took up our pain and bore our suffering, yet we considered him punished by God, stricken by him and afflicted. He was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that was brought on us, that brought us peace, was on him. He himself said, I will be the sacrifice. And there was nothing beautiful about it. The God who created the universe, our husband, our maker, becomes man. He says, I'm going to come to earth and I am going to take the punishment. I will become the lamb that will die. My blood, he talked about in Ezekiel, he washed the blood. How do we get washed from our sin? His blood comes and washes us clean of every sin, of every single thing that we struggle to get free from. And he says, I will cover you. I will wash you clean through my blood. I will give my own life in payment for yours. You know why? Because you can't help yourself. There is nothing that you can do to change your wicked heart, is what God says. There's nothing I can do. My heart is so desperately wicked, I see it every single day. And if you don't see that in your heart, then I don't know which planet you're living on. But until we get to heaven, I'm going to have to deal with this stinking heart. But the promise is that he covers it. I don't have to look at that and live in that. I come to him and say, I am free. I have a new identity. And you know what? Your identity is given to you by God's grace. It is by faith, through grace, that we are saved, not of ourselves. So I don't put on my new identity. I put on his identity. Anything I have is from him. He's my identity. And part of that identity means you're going to be rejected by the world. You will have to associate with being what he was, somebody who was hidden. You know, in the Old Testament, the example of the tabernacle was a type of Jesus, another type, picture pointing to Jesus. And for anybody who looked at it from the outside, it was pretty ugly. I think we might have had a photo of the tabernacle there, Dennis. It had badger skins. We just read about badger skins on their feet. Some say it was porpoise skins, whatever type of animal it was just very plain, but it was a protection, and the typology used is it was a protection for sin. But from the world's eyes, there's nothing very glorious about that. I mean, that's where God was coming to dwell, but what was attractive about that? The beauty was inside. If you go to the next one, Dennis, you can't see well here, but when you got inside, the light, the beauty, the gold, the silver was mind-blowing. But it wasn't until you got into the Holy of Holies that you really experienced the presence of God. And you know, today people are walking around, who's this Jesus? At the cross they said, take him away, we will not have this man to reign over us. And the world is still saying that. But there are those that the Holy Spirit is calling, like he called out to Rebecca, to say, come with me to meet the bridegroom. And you see something in him that is worth following. And you say, I've got nowhere else to go, got nothing else to do. Why wouldn't I follow this man who says he'll clothe me and crown me and make me new and give me everything? And why would I not follow him when he says he's my maker? Does he not know better than I do? And he says he's my husband. And I'm not talking about the physical relationships here. We all are being called into a spiritual marriage. Nothing about the sensual love of the human heart. It's about a spiritual intimacy with God. And guess what? When we get inside the tabernacle, when we accept Jesus, who he is, even though the world rejects him, when we don't see him in all his glory, we just accept Jesus, I'm a sinner, I need you. Can you put the photo of the Indian lady up for me, Dennis, and we'll close out here in a minute. But I used to drive past this lady in India every day. She was like washing herself, trying to wash herself. She didn't have a shower. She didn't have anything. She was just rubbing herself. She had a bottle of water. She was trying to clean herself up. And every day my heart would break and I couldn't speak the language and we were in a taxi. I didn't stop. I didn't know what to do. But it was such a picture to me of we're trying to wash ourselves off and we can't. We just say, Jesus, help me. We come to him and he washes us. He cleans us. He makes us new. He cleanses us from our sin. And then we start entering into the glory and finding out who he really is. Then we start to see his majesty. If you remember when the disciples were on the Mount of Transfiguration, they saw Jesus. They walked with him for 3 years and they didn't know who he was. And suddenly he reveals himself in all his glory. And they're like, wow, and they're on their knees. First, they want to worship Moses and Elijah. They're really confused. And then God says, this is my beloved son, listen to him. And whoa, they hit the deck. And they're like, wow. And I don't think they still really got it because they still all denied him at the cross. But in 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 16, Peter writes, we were eyewitnesses of his majesty. After the Holy Spirit came, Peter got it. They realized that they had seen majesty that was hidden in human form, that nobody wanted. Jesus wasn't a good-looking man. He says nobody would have desired his outward appearance. God's not looking at our outward appearance any more than he looked at Jesus' outward appearance. He's looking at hearts that will follow him. Hearts that will follow him. And when we follow him intimately, he will reveal his majesty to us, that he is our king. That's what makes us royal. Not because of anything I've done, everything that he's done. I finish with these scriptures on page 5. It says, now we see a dim reflection as in a mirror, but then we shall see face to face. Now I know in part, but then I shall know fully, even as I am fully known. We don't see it all now, but we are going to see it. Now we're looking through this hazy glass, but he's going to show us who he truly is. For it's God who commanded light to shine out of darkness, who has shone in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. We see God's glory when we look to Jesus. And we're going to do that more after lunch. But I've finished with this verse. Let your beauty be the hidden person of the heart, with the incorruptible beauty of a gentle and quiet spirit, which is very precious in the sight of God. That's one of those verses that you look at and get really convicted, isn't it? And you walk around the house saying, please, please, God, please help me to have a gentle, humble, quiet spirit. Please, Lord, I don't have that. Please help me. Do you do that? Like, oh my gosh, I am so far from this. So far from this. But it's precious in his sight. So then, like, please, Lord, convict me. Holy Spirit, help me to become that woman. Not so that others will say, oh, isn't she humble? Isn't she gentle? No. So that God can say, it's precious in my sight. So, Lord, change me as we look to you, completely transform us from glory to glory into your image, into the image of Jesus, as we look in his face. And I'd like to invite up to the platform a friend that I met a few weeks ago, Aretha. We met at an event that Yvonne Noriego had a few weeks ago down the street at Duo 58 called On the Couch. And Aretha is an amazingly gifted young woman, and she spoke that night. She shared her ministry is called Spoken Word. So she's very talented musically and spoken word and many other things. She has a great gift shop on Amazon, which I found some spectacular Christian gifts on there as well. And she's a mother of two young children. So she has a busy life. And I've asked her this morning to share a couple of things for us. And she's going to read the letter to the king's daughter first in this session. And then we're going to go into discussion about that. So thank you, Aretha.
My dear daughter, how I long for you to know my heart and desires for you. You are a precious child of the King, all glorious within. You are beautiful among women, awesome as an army with brightly colored banners. I clothe you in robes of many colors, embroidered with gold, leading you to me in purity, with gladness and rejoicing as you enter the palace of the king. My child, I have given you a crown of beauty instead of ashes, the oils of gladness instead of mourning, a garment of praise instead of despair, so that you will display my splendor. I have clothed you in the garment of salvation and arrayed you in a robe of righteousness as a bride adorned with jewels. I crown you with love and compassion and satisfy you with good things, giving you a rich welcome into my kingdom and a crown that will last forever. For you, dearest daughter, are a crown of splendor in my hand, a royal diadem in the hand of your God. In me, you are a beautiful new creation. I have given you new birth into a living hope and into an inheritance. that can never perish, spoil, or fade, kept in heaven for you. I have brought you into my royal family as my daughter, with complete access to my inheritance, blessing you with every spiritual blessing in Christ. I am your King and your God, who declares victories for you, the only ruler, the King of kings and the Lord of lords, who alone is immortal. I am coming soon. Hold on to what you have so that no one will take your crown. Until then, rest in the knowledge that I love you and I will never leave you nor forsake you. Remember that I am always with you, quieting you with my love and rejoicing over you with singing. Your heavenly Father, your lover, your bridegroom, your King.
Thank you, Aretha. We are going to hear from Aretha again after the next session. I loved watching your face when she was reading that. I don't know if you noticed, but her face was lighting up because she believes this stuff, right, Aretha? I don't know if you can hear me, but she believes it. I could see it coming through her face. If we don't understand and are not able to receive God's love for us as his daughters, it's really hard for us to understand being his bride. And so this morning in your discussion group, you're just going to take a few minutes, 10 minutes, to just discuss two questions that you'll find at the back of your book on the back page for that first session. And just what in that letter speaks to your heart and is meaningful to you? Which aspect, which line, which word? And then the second question is, which one do you struggle with? Because some of that, we read it and we say, oh, that's for somebody else, that's not for me. And I would ask you, take off your religious eyes and look at this with the eyes of your heart. This is something that God is speaking to you personally. Can you receive it?